Good evening, everybody. Welcome. And Steve, we'll hope that your lights come back on any moment.
Good job.
So, crowdfunding, it's a new word. It's not a new concept by any stretch of the imagination. And we're going to concentrate just on this very short introduction on crowdfunding in music. Crowdfunding is exactly what it sounds like. It's money that comes from different people at different times in different amounts, and for different reasons. And we'll get in a little later to why that's important, because the reasons people decide to give to a particular crowdfunding campaign are reasons that you can strategically highlight, and that's great for you. Crowdfunding's not complicated. All that money comes together from all those different people and all those different sources to support an idea. And that idea has value. It has a monetary value. Based upon the platform you decide to use for your crowdsourcing, you assign a monetary value to different benefits. You assign a monetary value to the project itself. But keep that in your brain, the idea that you assign value to something in particular, because that goes straight to the definition of what an entrepreneur is, and that's what this is really all about. Crowdfunding's not new. The earliest examples are 400 years old plus. The first one is the British East India Company, which crowdfunded by collecting money and giving out shares in a project. 123 years later, a little upstart company in Holland did exactly the same thing and made even more money, specifically to export from colonial territories and increase trade. So in 1620, the very first time anybody crowdsourced anything in England, it raised £1.6 million. Now, that's at a time when that little guy up there, our expert stone cutter who's building St. Paul's Cathedral and all those other places, made £9 a year. That's 7 cents a day. So just for scale, that's all that's for. In 2014, that £1.6 million is $488 million plus. And that's all to go after pepper, sugar, and tea. So essentially breakfast. Keep in mind that the value of your idea will very often equal its popularity, and that your assessment of value plays a key role in there. Entrepreneurship means simply creating value. That's it. Nothing else. That is the simplest, most stripped-down definition that there is. And defining that value starts with how you formulate your project. The first platform everybody knows about is called Kickstarter. It is a project-centric approach, which simply means that the projects have a beginning and a middle and an end. There is a goal to that project. The thing you see on the slide right now is one of the top three monetary successes for Kickstarter. That's a Bluetooth watch that goes with either your iPhone or your Android. So an additional, or an initial rather, goal of $100,000 to develop and sell the project exploded to $10 million, and that was fully funded on Kickstarter. Another platform is called PeerBacker. This started as specifically as an IT crowd fundraising mechanism that now is more business-centric. You can go onto PeerBacker to find backing for frontline retail, for online stores, for ongoing processes. It's not necessarily a project thing that has a specific end, but rather a process that will keep going. The Donors Choose platform is great for educators. It is specifically for what they term as frontline teachers. So if you've got charge of a classroom, if you've got charge of a regular rehearsal schedule, if you've got charge of a regular ensemble, this is you. And the reason that the ICA logo is up there is I came across Donors Choose quite by accident. I got an email that came across. I don't even think it was an email. I think it was a Facebook feed that a middle school band director in New Jersey wanted to raise money for a bass clarinet. And so because I'm on the mailing list for ICA, I happened to get this. So in a week, that middle school teacher had the $3,500 necessary for a bass clarinet, and in less than 2 weeks had enough of a run over from that to buy two bass clarinets. So that's an example of something that's incredibly targeted. It was sent out to bass clarinet players. So of course we want kids to play bass clarinet. Who doesn't want to play the bass clarinet? So we're going to run on now to the three examples that we are going to talk about this evening are all from Kickstarter. And we're going to start off with Aaron's. This was actually to record an album for his group, Bending and Breaking. Abby's project was music education oriented. It was a series of videos for string education, and it blew out its goal from $2,750 to $3,385. And then the Sound Exchange Orchestra, or I should say Sound Exchange Ensemble, which originally had a $12,000 goal, made its goal and then some, and that's Emily Wozniak's project. So I'm going to keep these slides up as we go back for sort of an introduction to each of our other three panelists. That's the thumbnail, obscenely quick introduction of what crowdfunding is. The mechanism is simply this. Particularly on Kickstarter, you introduce with some prose, usually a video, sometimes a recording, sometimes just pictures and prose, what your project is. People involved in supporting that project are given incentives at each level of support. So if you come in at, and I'm making this up, Aaron, if you come in at $100 of support for your album project, what did they get?
I will also make it up and say, I think it was you got videos explaining all the pieces, as well as an album, as well as exclusive videos of concerts.
Okay.
I think that's around, and a t-shirt, I think, probably for $100 too.
Perfect. Abby, what were some of your incentives along the way?
Well, lessons, Skype lessons, or in person for people who were in the area.
Okay.
Dedicating videos that I have. That was what I was doing, was creating videos, dedicating videos to donors. And then doing charity work in their honor, essentially.
Okay. So kind of like a naming opportunity.
Yeah.
Perfect. Emily, how about the supporters of Sound Exchange?
We had, I think, very simple ways of thanking people, from putting their name on the website, putting them in the program, announcing their name at a concert. I think the highest level was that a small group of musicians from our ensemble would come perform at the donor's location of choice. And some people actually donated at that level but chose not to have the reward. They just wanted to give.
So. Stayed anonymous. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm going to give the screen back to our webinar here rather than my own screen and just ask, when we did this program live, we were talking about each of the three of you treating this as a project that you tended to every day, that you checked on, that you supported, that you pushed, that you talked about, that you talked up, that you used media to share the message. Emily, when you put this together and you knew that you had a set amount of time to crowdsource $12,000, aside from the stress level, what were some of the things that you did every day to keep this on people's radar?
I think all of us will probably say you're emailing nonstop. All the time. Either you're sending Facebook messages or you're like going through your spreadsheet and just emailing.
Okay.
So the contact just, it it didn't really end. And, you know, if I wasn't getting it through email and directing people to the Kickstarter, I went and met them in person and talked to them about it to try to get them excited. So it was just, at this point, I think when I did this project, it was 2 years ago, I had no idea what I was doing, so I just tried absolutely everything, which was stressful.
Erin, you said in the live version of this panel discussion that you were terrified, that this was something that was out of your, not just your realm of experience, but that you didn't feel comfortable doing because it seemed to push a very personal agenda. Is that fairly accurate?
Yeah, I always felt awkward growing up and still today asking for help for things. You know, I always felt like if I couldn't do it on my own, that then I needed to find a way to do it. Yep. And it was always a little bit uncomfortable to say to someone, like, could I please have some money? Because, you know, everybody has things in their life that they need money for. So it was hard for me to get to the point where I felt like my idea was important enough or special enough that people would want to help. Once I started doing it, I was pleasantly surprised that a lot of people believed in what I was doing and didn't mind my asking at all. And so I feel like it was a good experience for me to learn to ask when I need help. There was no way I could have done my project with what I had by myself. So I needed to find a way to reach out, and luckily there was a great community of people willing to be helpful and interested enough in the rewards and what they would get out of it to make it work. So we did. We met our goal, and it was everything worked out just as planned, I guess.
Abby, how much of a stress of a stretch was this for you, just personally, to ask for financial help for a project?
Well, you know, definitely what Erin was saying about, you know, not liking to ask for help or liking to ask for money, I can definitely relate to that. The Kickstarter project that you have the slide for, that was actually my second one.
Mm-hmm. And
I think by the time I'd gotten to that, well, I was fortunate enough that enough people were familiar with my work already that I didn't really hardly have to ask. I just sort of put it out there, and, you know, with my video, and I guess it was posted on my YouTube video or my YouTube page with all my other videos, and so The network that I already had established was enough that I didn't really have to be aggressive with it at all.
Okay.
It just sort of funded itself in a fairly short amount of time. The first project I had to work a little bit harder on, and I did ask, you know, family members, and I think I probably posted it on Facebook or whatever. And so for that first one, I did have to work a little harder at it and push a little harder, which I found to be somewhat uncomfortable. That part of the process was already taken care of. So I guess, yeah, putting in the work ahead of time made it so that then when I actually did the crowdfunding thing, that it wasn't a big deal particularly.
Okay. I'm gonna pose this to the people listening and to each of the three of you as we did, in a slightly different way. I'm gonna suggest to you that simply by being on the Kickstarter platform, or Donors Choose, or Peer Backers, or whatever you decide to do, you have entered into a marketplace where people are interested in funding you. This is one of the very first concepts we talk about in charity versus philanthropy. One is strategic, one is not. And the instant you find yourself on Kickstarter, you are in a marketplace. And you guys, as people with projects, have entered that marketplace. So, Erin, I was particularly happy to hear you talk so openly and honestly about, okay, I have problems asking for help when I need it, when there's money attached to it. And one of the fantastic things about philanthropy right now, today, is it is getting vastly easier for people who are Gen X, Gen Y, millennials to talk about and to use financial resources in open and creative ways. I find that very exciting. For those of you listening in on the webinar, Emily and I, in addition to being musicians, I'm a clarinet player and a conductor, Emily is a horn player and an orchestra manager, but we both have an enormous amount of experience in raising money. We are now, and both have been in our careers, development officers. So the idea that you are asking for something, that it is somehow something that you are asking with diffidence or with worry, is not something you have to worry about. You're putting a project out there that you believe in, and your goal is to find other people who believe in it as well so that it can actually happen. So the faster you get past the idea that you're asking for charity or that you're asking for a favor or that you are somehow cringing at the idea that somebody's going to say no to you, you don't have to worry about that. Everybody's going to say no to you at one point in your life or another, and you're entitled to feel horrible about it for 5 minutes, and then you move on. For whatever reason, it's especially pointed when we talk about financial resources, because it's a gift rather than earned income. And there's a whole nother talk in there somewhere. But the idea that someone would believe in a project that you have to the level that you do so that they would support it financially is really phenomenal. So I'm very pleased that all of you have had such a terrific experience with it, and that it made you stretch a little bit about how you communicate, about what you're comfortable with, about how you model and put together your ask. Did all of you have exclusively prose or exclusively videos on your Kickstarter page? Aaron, I know you had a video.
Yeah, I had a video. I think I wrote about it a fair amount, too. I tend to be wordy all the time, so I definitely had some things that weren't in the video, but the video was important to me, that it wasn't too long, but that it got everything. It got people that were watching it as excited about it as I was excited about it. I think that's important. Like you talked about believing in your project.
Right.
I think I've seen some things like this where the people kind of didn't believe in it as much, or like I was worried, but I certainly didn't want to let on that I was worried when I was asking people, you know, in a video saying like, I'm really scared that this won't work, so please help me, you know.
Are you worried desperate when you perform with Bending and Breaking?
Oh yeah, sometimes, sure. Sure, sometimes it's terrifying, you know, but for the same reason, though, because you don't know if it's going to work out the way you want it to, I think.
Right.
And you don't want to be embarrassed and not do your best in front of people. So the only difference, though, is I think as a musician and as a performer, I at least know that I can count on my skills that I've honed and developed. And as a money raiser, I didn't have any of those at first, although I guess I do now. So that's the biggest difference, you know. My level of comfort wasn't based on something I've worked on for my whole life.
Well, and so I would present to all of you on the panel, as we've already spoken about individually and collectively, but everybody listening, if you are a musician and you perform, you are already invested in a public message. You already do what you believe in. You already take an audience with you in a performance. As a teacher, you take a student with you through an instructional journey or through a lecture or a class or a master class, what have you. You already have the skills to put forth what you believe in. Emily was putting forth this fundraising campaign for an ensemble. Any different for you?
Yeah, I think since I felt a lot of pressure but also a lot of motivation because it wasn't just for me. I had a whole group of people whose entire season depended on that money. I felt very strongly that I wanted to raise money to pay musicians and to take the concerts to the next level, and that was a huge motivating factor for me. I think before it started, I promised the people in our group that we would get it. And I mean, I had never done it before, but I promised them that we would get it. And so, like, that every day was resting on my shoulders, I guess.
But so you had confidence at the beginning to, you either loved the idea enough or loved the people or loved the ensemble to say, this is absolutely going to happen. And you deployed the skills necessary to make it happen. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, but I wouldn't call it confidence because I didn't have confidence that I could do it. I just knew I would do whatever it would take.
Period. Okay.
But also I think our project was very community-oriented and we were all Eastman students, and so we wanted to do something for the community because our education was based, you know, on Gibbs Street in this one school, and we kind of wanted to break out and shake things up a little bit. So that was a motivating factor too.
Excellent. Abby, what kind of motivation did you have as a teacher to want to put down information that somebody could access at any time in a video, wherever they were, in whatever circumstances in which they found themselves, so that your detail and your immediacy as a teacher could be accessed? What was your motivation there?
Well, I think I have several different levels of motivation. You know,
okay.
At the bottom line, I needed to pay my bills, and I had been making videos like this for a while, just doing it because I thought it was helpful to have out there. I'm doing it for free, and that wasn't paying the bills.
Okay.
So there was that. But, you know, I did feel strongly that my product was helping people. You know, I had already been getting emails from people not only asking for more videos, but saying, oh, this helped me so much. I had to do this audition and blah, 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 blah. So there was that, you know, sort of feedback that I was getting that people wanted what I was doing and that it was helping people.
That's huge. People wanted what you had to present. And I would posit that people wanted to have what all three of you presented in varying degrees, whether that was instruction, whether that was the ability to see an ensemble, whether that was the ability to hear bending and breaking, what have you. That's a huge concept. I'm delighted that you said it. Where would you put that on your level? What level would that be, Abby?
I would like to say that was the highest level. I mean, certainly it was the most lofty. But there was, I mean, let's be honest, the pay your bills thing is really important.
And earning the money necessary as a musician and as a teacher is very, very often what this comes down to, whether that is project or process based. Aaron, you had mentioned that this was stepping outside yourself. There's some self-doubt involved. Post-project, how confident are you in stuff that maybe you weren't confident in before? What's this done for you long-term, aside from produce a recording for Bending and Breaking?
Well, I don't know that I would, I guess it shows me that I can, you know, achieve things outside of my level of comfort. It shows me that I have a lot of friends and a lot of people behind me that I guess I didn't realize maybe were there as, in the capacity that they actually are. Can you hear me okay? My thing is like... Okay.
Yeah, no, I've got you. How often do you step outside your comfort level in the classroom? Because I know your 9-to-5 is general music.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I guess kind of in a broad perspective. I never really thought about it that way. Because I guess the best way to think about it for me would be I worked hard at this and I prepared a lot and I put a lot into it. And so I think if I do that with something else, I can expect similar results. Maybe, I guess I don't think about it on a daily basis, but like I'm getting right now ready for these Fringe Festival concerts next week where I'm playing drum solos that people wrote. And, like, they're so hard. I'm really scared. They're really hard. I'm going to practice as soon as we're done again. But I guess, you know, thinking about it like this, if I think about it, the fact that as long as I put in the effort and am committed to it and believe in what I'm doing, I can be successful. So hopefully that's true.
That, in a nutshell, is what I concentrate on in my classes and the Arts Leadership Program at Eastman, at the Institute for Music Leadership. As I very often say to both classes, the organizational and the individual classes, you have in your history, in your skill set, most of the stuff you need to succeed in fundraising, in nonprofit management, in formulating an idea and putting it forward. You may not have put those things together in the order in which we work, but you do have the skills. Emily, you've been through both of those classes. Was there something for which you thought maybe you didn't have at all, that at the end of this project you said, oh yeah, I can absolutely do that now?
I think it's kind of witnessing yourself and the people you work with be fearless together to try to accomplish something, because I think you asked, Aaron, like, if it gets easier. When you're constantly trying something new, or like making a new album or performing a new piece, or our group always plays in different venues with different collaborators, it is always terrifying. And I think just seeing yourself being willing to be fearless with other people helps your confidence a little, because the fear doesn't really go away ever. Like, we've been doing this, we're in our fourth year now, and Fringe Festival this year, the third time around, is still like another huge terrifying thing because it's brand new. But you're willing to do it with other people who are committed to experimenting. And that's cool to see. And you have to be able to trust yourself in that process, I guess. That makes sense.
I would agree.
It wouldn't really be fun if it wasn't hard.
Right, exactly. It would be boring, yeah.
Exactly. And a little terror is a good thing, he said, as Fringe approached.
Yeah, so, like some. Less would be good, but some is good.
There you go. So, Steve, that's our introduction, and that's the first round of stuff for our panel. I'm going to ask Abby and Emily and Aaron if there is anything they would like to continue with, either as a continuation of an idea we've already touched on that you want to say something more about, before we throw it open back to you, Steve, for questions and a wrap-up.
Nothing in particular.
Okay, I have one, and I didn't mention this beforehand, but I'll put Emily on the spot just because I can, basically. So, Emily, you are a development officer for the Eastman School of Music. How much easier, how much more difficult, how much change has there been in your ability to meet one-on-one with somebody and put forth the idea of financial support for, in this case, an institution, but lots of different ideas within that institution?
I would say it's easier and more gratifying to work with people one-on-one versus address the masses. I've never been someone who likes a lot of public attention on me. I like talking to people one-on-one and figuring out what they're passionate about, and then instead of thinking of it as asking them for something, I think of partnering their passion with Eastman, and I believe in Eastman, so that conversation is genuine to me, and I think it would be really difficult if I was working for a school or an organization I didn't believe in. I could never, ever do this job, ever.
And that's huge. Difficult. The idea of being genuine, whether that is for cello instruction, or your band, or your ensemble, that is at the heart of any successful fundraising effort. It's the idea that you are maintaining an open and genuine approach to what you're doing, because if you don't believe in it, nobody else will. So as you formulate a project, as you pick what it is you'd like to support or what you'd like to do, make sure it's something that resonates with you to such a degree that you would be willing to go out there and talk to anybody about it. I say that to colleagues, I say that to board members, I say that to students and to fellow musicians and to administrators. it sounds sort of overly lofty sometimes, but it's really a very basic underpinning idea of philanthropic support of music and really all the arts, but we're all musicians here, and that's important for me to mention. Oh, there's one other thing. Sorry, if I could do that. Wow. This just blew in. So we've got Aaron at Fringe in Rochester, and a really interesting list of 100 important recordings, which I have since echoed on my Tumblr. We've got Sound Exchange performing at Fringe and doing some incredibly exciting stuff with collaborations with folks at RIT. Abby, are we going to expect to see some more cello instruction and string instruction in the future?
Well, I'm still teaching, of course, but no, probably not.
All right.
I've been working on different things in life these days, and it's just not quite my focus at this point.
Will you likely come back to Kickstarter or to a similar platform when there is, given your success?
I would if the occasion arose, because certainly I found it very, very, very helpful, and very user-friendly.
Cool.
But I have no plans in the immediate future to do it.
Alrighty. So we'll see you as a spectator at Fringe here in Rochester at some point. Okay, Steve, back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. So just to remind everyone, we absolutely do want to have your questions as well, and there's a question box located on your webinar control panel. So I encourage you to go ahead and type a question in there and send it in, and we can discuss it. We do have a number that have come in. I'm just going to go right into them and get going. So the first one is, how did you go about creating a budget for your project?
Who's going to jump in first?
I was pretty practical about mine. I knew exactly what I was trying to do. I wanted to record an album of my music and get it out to the masses. So I just asked other people who had done that already. It's, you know, a relatively standardized process, so I knew I needed to be able to record it at a studio and pay for someone to mix and master it, and then pay for, I wanted to have some money to get copies printed, like CDs, and I also wanted a budget for to have some money for like press stuff, to be able to hire a publicist or some kind of marketing assistance. So I kind of just got quotes like you would do if you were getting your car repaired, and asked around like what would it cost, and just added those up, because I didn't want to overshoot. With Kickstarter, if you raise more than your goal, that raises much more as you can, but if you don't meet your goal, you get nothing. So I wanted to be really careful to both make sure I had enough money to carry out what I wanted, but also that I didn't, you know, leave a lot of extra in there for like snacks and things like that when I really didn't need it.
Right.
So I just kind of added it all up, and it came to about $7,000, and I really ended up with very little left over, so that was kind of a good way of doing it for what I was trying to do when other people had already done it.
Okay.
I guess I'll go next. I just basically guesstimated about how many hours I thought it would take me to produce the number of videos that I had in mind, and then I just times that, multiplied that by how much I usually charge for an hour worth of teaching. And that was it.
Okay.
It was very, very, very straightforward, although, you know, that initial estimation of how long it was going to take me, I actually don't even know how accurate that was in the end. I just sort of took as much time as it really did take me. And it's what I felt okay about it, you know, in terms of I felt that I had been compensated for my time without, mm-hmm. you know, having taken advantage of anyone who was giving money. So it seemed to work out fairly and evenly to me.
Excellent. Emily, you were dealing with an ensemble full of people. How did your budgeting go?
kind of just like Aaron said, but when we launched this Kickstarter, we had kind of been at it for about a year, so we did everything as volunteers and performed concerts as an ensemble of anywhere from 20 to 50 people on our school's campus. So I had an idea of what was needed. I knew I wanted to pay musicians, but it's really difficult to get a lot of undergrads from Eastman over to a campus 20 minutes away. You need multiple buses. You need to pay to copy the music, like Aaron was saying. You need to be able to promote the concert. So all of that stuff adds up. So I just, you know, made a spreadsheet, but then somebody recommended that I add way more money than I thought I would need. And I thought that that was a stupid move, but I just did it as a risk and we ended up getting it, which was good. But yeah, I was dealing with 50 people, which was the challenge. So it was naturally going to be a higher number.
Absolutely. Steve, have we got another question?
Yeah, we have another great question here. Which is, how many donors approximately did you have, and how many of them didn't you know? How many of these people were people that you knew? Do you even know that? But how many people were people that you had contacted and, like Emily was saying, reached out to, and how many people just contributed to your project and you didn't even know them?
I think for hours I knew all of them except maybe two or three. Or someone in our, it wasn't just me raising this money, it was maybe like four of us in the ensemble. Mm-hmm. It was people we knew, people in Rochester and all over the country.
So that was, as you can see from the slide there, 92 backers for Sound Exchange and 40 for Abby's Cello Technique and 200 for Aaron's project. That's a big family, Aaron.
Well, I mean, yeah, it looks like Emily's backers had a lot more money than mine did, though. I mean, I guess, you know, what's interesting about the world today is that, like, when you say, like, people, who did you know? But I don't know that I knew everybody, like, personally that I'd shaken their hand before. But, I mean, you know, a friend of a friend or I had done some things in Toronto where I played at some clubs in Toronto, and then those people ended up on my mailing list, and then those people got an email, and, like, I don't know if I actually know them, you know what I mean, but they had met me or her, so I don't know if that counts. And I think it depends on what kind of project you're doing, because, like, for Abby's, those people had, like, a specific, you know, takeaway from that. Like, they got this video that would help them improve. But I think for my or Emily's project, where the thing that you're getting, I guess, is more of a experience in one way or the other, it's hard, you know, I don't know if I actually knew everybody. That doesn't really make sense, does it?
But they knew you, and they knew
somehow, yeah,
the project through one of those avenues that you described. They knew you, there was a connection made, and the connection was strong enough for them to go, yeah, I want to support that. I'll absolutely do that.
If they didn't know me, they at least knew about it, or they knew what I did, and they liked it enough to want to support it. So, friends, I don't know, half of them maybe were people I, like, could call up right now. Maybe.
Excellent.
For mine, again, my two Kickstarter projects were sort of different in this way. The first one, I did ask friends and family, and I think I probably... Oh, and students' parents. I asked some of my students' parents, and a few of them chipped in. So I probably knew about half of the people in my first one that was funded. And my second project, though, I didn't even notify friends and family, really, that I was doing it. And so it was pretty much, or pretty close to 100% people I didn't know.
Okay.
But who knew of me through my YouTube channel, but who I had never met.
Got it. Steve, next question?
Yeah, another question that came in is, and this sort of runs back to what we were talking about earlier, but what to you was the greatest challenge with funding your project and putting this whole thing together?
You want to dive in first, Emily?
Yeah, I think what Aaron said was self-esteem. Throughout the thing, it's really, really difficult to ask for money for something that you're trying to do on your own. I felt, like, selfish. I felt a lot of different things, but I think it was keeping up morale throughout the whole thing, which sounds really kind of pathetic, but it was the first time I had done anything like that, and it was just, it feels weird to ask for money the first time. But I don't know. It feels very uncomfortable, I think.
So rather than ask for money, how about offer an opportunity to be part of something really exciting?
Right.
How about get somebody involved with exactly what you believe in for the same reason, or an allied reason, or a reason maybe you haven't even thought of yet? But I'm delighted to hear you talk about it in that way, because it was exactly the same way for me as well. You want me to do what? For who? For how much? It's outside of our realm of experience, and it ought not be. So there should be a webinar about that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I would just second what Emily said. It's just sort of taking that step to assert to the world that what you have is valuable, and that they should see that, they should recognize that, to sort of... it feels like a very arrogant position to be taking. Seems sort of immodest, I guess, to say that, yeah, you should pay me for what I do. Even though, really, it's reasonable that a person should get paid for what they do. But that can be a hard just step to take. I think just getting past that initial fear or whatever it is.
And one of the reasons that is hard for us as musicians is because we spend, depending on when we began, we spend our entire growing up time, our entire adolescence, much of our young adulthood, concentrating solely on the application of our skill to a particular project or a particular process. That's an inward turning process. That's, okay, I got to learn this, and then I got to do that. I got to learn this, and I got to do that. We are not told, at least on the school side, guess what? As a musician, not only are you out there giving your all to an audience, but you are convincing them through the sheer act of performance that what you're doing is valuable. And that means you have to put a price on it. So I'm really delighted to hear, well, everyone this evening, as I always am, talk about the journey about coming to that realization, because every musician has to do that at one point or another.
Great. Another question that's come in goes back, I think, to something that Mark, you had said at the beginning, and the question says, you mentioned that different people will contribute for different reasons.
Yes.
Are there projects where that seemed to be the case, and it says maybe Emily's? Question mark.
Okay. Go for it, Emily. I can mention a couple of things, but go first. That's a great question.
Yeah, I guess one example would be, there was one donor who gave, gosh, I think it was $1,000, and I had never met this person. I didn't know who it was. It was a friend of, like, kind of a friend, but definitely someone I didn't know. But she gave a significant amount of money and then, like, really, really wanted to have members of our ensemble play at her, like, holiday party. And ever since that, she always comes back, and she comes to our shows, and we send the shows to her like parties or whatever it is she like wants music for. And it's like it's a great relationship, because she really cares about what we do and we want to perform, so it works. And then there are people who just wanted to give to the project. I think because they wanted to take a chance on young people who had adventurous ideas. And when you give to things on Kickstarter, you don't know if they'll actually succeed at all. I mean, we're young people asking for money, and at that point, like 2 years ago, we could have definitely, like, not thrown on some good concerts. So some people are willing to take a risk, and then some people want the reward.
Yep. The reason that I said for different reasons speaks to your ability as the presenter of the idea to not just talk about it as your own passion, not just talk about it as your own interest as a performer or as an administrator or as a communicator, but to try to hook in to why someone who's not intimately acquainted with what you do, why they would be interested in it. And live performance is rife with different ways to hook somebody into that experience. It's an incredibly rich field from which to draw multiple interests. And I don't think it exists in a painting or in a sculpture or even in the spoken word. I think to perform the spoken word, I'll say the written word, the spoken word's a little bit different, but I think the act of live performance offers an unusually wide range of things for people to key into, get excited about, and participate in. And in this case, participate in by supporting it financially.
Great. I'll probably have time for a couple more questions. And another good one that's come in is, how did you differentiate your project from the many projects on these websites, or did you feel like your project was unique from the start?
I never thought about it. I mean, I didn't make any effort to find out if there were similar projects. It just never occurred to me, really. But seemed like a non-issue, I guess. Worked out all right. So I guess it must have been unique enough.
Well, I think for mine, there's a lot of... there were and are even more now. A lot of this kind of thing. Like, I'd like to make an album with my band. Way more now than there were a couple years ago, I think, when I did it. But I think the big thing when you look at whether it's mine or Abby's or Emily's, if you go to the website and you look at it for a minute, I think all of ours look really professional, and it really, you can tell that we cared about what we were doing. Yep. While we were making it. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I reshot my video and like thought about what I was wearing and like when would I wear my glasses and when would I not, and like, I mean, really, I thought about it way more than you would imagine, maybe at first, because I wanted it to be it mattered so much to me, you know. So if it mattered so much to me, then I wanted to put everything I had into it. And I've seen, I mean, I did look at other ones, you know, and there are some videos out there for bands, and it looks like the Blair Witch Project, you know, like the person's so close and they're sweating and it's shot in their living room and they're, you know, it's, and like, I look at that and think, like, what is this person going to do with the money that I give them, you know? And it just, I think it's a reflection, just like when you go to play a concert and you think about, you know, do you look okay? You know, you would make sure that your clothes weren't wrinkled, and you would make sure that you had, you know, done your hair however you do it. I think that stuff matters when you're presenting your project to somebody, because even though you're not doing it live, you're still, it's a reflection of what you are and what you represent. And so for me, I wanted mine to stand out just, you know, without having like fancy cameras or anything like that. Within my means, I wanted it to look as professional and as, I guess that's the word I would use. I wanted it to look as professional and as complete as possible, and that goes too for anything that I wrote. You know, if I wrote a paragraph, I had somebody else read it and say, like, does this sound stupid or does this sound like it's okay? Does this sound like me saying it or does this sound like somebody else wrote it for me? I think all those things make a big difference, and I know that the other two people on this panel did the same thing, whether, you know, whether it was at the forefront of their mind when they made the stuff or not, it all came across that way. And I, you know, I know for sure, like, when people around town talk about the sound exchange, it's it sounds different. You know, there's a lot of orchestras around here, but it's a different kind of thing. Like, the personal branding that has gone on with that group is something that really sets it apart. You know, and now we have the Fringe Festival coming up, and there are, like, probably 50 or 100 things that you could go to. And, you know, Emily's project is at the top of my list of things to go see because of that. You know, because I have met her a couple times, and I know how much she cares about it, and that's, to me, what makes it worthwhile. You know, and the quality will be great too, but that's like almost an afterthought, you know.
Thanks, Jeremy. But I'll just, I mean, I'll return it. I feel the same way about Aaron's show. I mean, not only do I know it's going to be quality music, but the way he presents it is totally his personality, and we're not even friends, but I like want to be there because it's him and I don't know him that well, but like his posters scream his personality. The language he used to describe his project, like, is him, and it's not contrived. It's very genuine, and it has character, and I think that's what attracts us to projects and just to artists in general.
Agreed. Agreed.
Great. All right, well, one last question before we let our wonderful panelists and moderator go this evening. A good one to wrap up on. Is there anything that you would do differently in your next crowdfunding project?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I could do another one.
I don't want to say that.
But not. But like, because, like, I don't know. Like, just like I said at the beginning, how hard it was to ask once. Like, imagine asking twice. You know,
I promise it gets easier.
But I feel like for me, like, asking once was okay. You know, it would be like the difference between if my dad gave me help towards my down payment on my house versus if he paid half of my mortgage every month.
Got it.
You know, like, one time is okay to get me off my feet, and I was, you know, 26 years old or whatever. But, like, now I'm a big boy, so now I don't know. I kind of feel like doing another one, it would have to be something really different, because I think hitting that same market up again, they would just respond that way. Like, well, I already helped you one time. Why, you know, maybe that's just my own inherent fear.
So this really was a Kickstarter for you.
Yeah, there you go. Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think that I would respond kind of the same way if I try to donate to as many as I can that I believe in, but I feel the same way. Like, if I saw somebody do, like, two or three in a row for a similar thing, I'd be, you know, if it was the same type of project. Like, I know, Abby, you did it, but it was, like, it wasn't the same kind of thing that I'm talking about, I know. I would feel the same way. Like, why, well, you know, by now I should be making enough money to be able to do that again with, you know, and have enough. So I don't know. Maybe that wasn't the right thing to say. I would struggle with this.
I would totally buy that answer. Absolutely. Emily? Abby, go ahead.
So I did try doing a third project, and it was a completely and totally unrelated thing and something that I wasn't sort of already established in. You know, I mean, the cello stuff, people knew me as a cellist. As a cello teacher, I kind of had a reputation that I could, I suppose you could say, cash in on, and that there was demand there already for that product. And then I tried another one that was completely unrelated, and it failed, mainly because I didn't, you know, I tried to take the sort of hands-off approach that worked so well for the first two, just like, put it out there, if you want it, great, if not, fine. And that worked for the first two, but for this third one that was unrelated and that I didn't have that network established, like, failure. And then I just kind of, after a few days when I was like, oh, you mean I'm going to have to really ask people and push this? I just decided not to.
Okay.
It was just that, no, I don't really want to be that aggressive about it, so I'm just going to let it die. And I feel okay with that, but, you know, certainly, if I wanted, was really that invested in that project, I would have had to take a different approach and just try harder, essentially, to get people involved and get people to see my vision as I saw it.
Yep. Emily, anything different?
Yeah, I think it's definitely not one of those things where you wake up and you're like, oh, I'm going to do a Kickstarter again. Like, I would never, ever feel that way. I would do it again if the musicians in our group really, really, again, believed in something and we needed money for it. I would do it again, but I would do it totally differently. I would plan for it way ahead of time. And I think go out and ask people and get a feel for what they would be willing to pledge for this type of project and base the amount of money on that, so that it didn't feel like a free-for-all when the project launched and you're just sending emails all the time, everybody you know. I would just want a little bit more of a plan for my own sanity.
So you would actually do some real resource development for the next one?
Yeah, but I think other projects, I don't know how the projects who, the ones where they get like 50 grand, how much planning they do, or if they just go viral, or if it's a combination of the two. I don't know.
Wonderful. Well, I want to take this opportunity. We have 1 minute left. This is perfect timing. I want to thank our panelists and our moderator for taking the time to speak with us this evening. I think it's been a really fun and informative webinar on this topic of crowdfunding that certainly lots of musicians are very interested in. So thank you all. Thanks to everyone for attending tonight, being with us, and visit polyphonic.org to see the recorded version of this. You can share with your friends and colleagues, and we certainly hope you'll join us for the webinars in October and November. We're going to have in October a webinar, sort of open a forum on careers in music. You can ask questions, get answers from some experts. And in November, 10 tips for social media success. So that should also be excellent. So I want to thank Mark Powell for being our leader tonight. Thank you very much for all your work.
My pleasure. Good to be with you.
Abby, Miku Griffa, Emily Wozniak, and Aaron Stabell, thank you for sharing your projects with us. And best of luck in the future. We hope to hear great things from all of you very soon.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Have a good night, everyone.